Hello guys, Bashar here. We are together with another Grim Dawn build video. So in the first build video, I have showed you the Eye of Reckoning, Cyclone, Whirlwind, Templar. That was my first character after coming back to the game after 3 years. As you can imagine, it was very lacking because there are a lot of crafting recipes in Grim Dawn, and by a lot, guys, I mean putting every single game to shame. I'm sure there are hundreds and hundreds, if not a thousand or so. Like I said, and I'm not even exaggerating, guys. I'm sure there's like at least 400 or 500 recipes, and after some point they become quite rare. I mean, getting them is quite rare. I mean, I'm still missing a lot of recipes for the stuff. So like I said, that Eye of Reckoning Templar guy was seriously lacking after some point. So I thought I would make a new character that's more powerful, and I also got the Gazer Man here. Yeah, this one. I mean, it was similar to this one. So I got the leveling gear, like I mentioned with the shortcut video, guys. So, and I wanted to make a character that kills Lokar. Lokar is here, guys. Where is it? Where is Lokar? That's here. Let me show you. That's Lokar set, and as you can see, it gives plus one to all skills and 40% XP gain, and it provides nice beneficial abilities, unlike the Miss Gazer Man or the Gazer Man, which give you penalties to your armor and offensive and defensive ability, and after some point you get quickly one shotted. Anyway, let's move on to the build. So guys, I wanted a build that has the weapons should be within my reach. That's what I wanted, because with the first build I only had a weaker version of the weapon, and the build couldn't climb anymore after some point. So with this build, guys, we are using double Storm Hearts, and Storm Heart is granted by a quest. So every single person has access to these. I mean, of course, you can do the quest line once per character, so you need two characters. But I mean, like I said, it's not very hard to do. I mean, you have to survive in Steps of Torment a little bit, but it's before the end boss. I mean, you can just pick an evasive route. I mean, maybe finishing Steps of Torment could be classified as moderately hard, but like I said, getting to this point is not very hard. There are a lot of guides for the Mythical Stormheart quest, so we are dual wielding Stormhearts, and we will be using Korvac's brand. And as you can see, this one is bad as well. Requires level 58 only. I mean, I don't have the real version, the level 94 version. So this one allows us to dual wield, because our class combination cannot actually dual wield. So this is one is a must. And as for the other stuff, guys, as you can expect from a weapon called Stormheart, everything that we do is almost lightning damage. As you can see, like 95% is lightning and electrocute. Electrocute is the damage over time component of lightning. So like I said, everything that boosts lightning damage is welcome. So as you can, and elemental damage also counts. So lightning damage, elemental damage, lightning damage, lightning, elemental, lightning, lightning, and lightning. And added lightning damage is pretty nice, guys, because we have a lot of lightning damage bonus. So even though 7 to 20 lightning damage doesn't look much, it actually is a lot, because we have a hundreds and hundreds percent of lightning damage bonus. Let me see if there is a that's retaliation though. We have a lot of lightning damage bonus, so added lightning damage bonus is actually quite a lot, and our attack speed is fine. So this is I'm making the order a bit wrong, but guys, this is a fire strike build. So we actually use default attacks to kick ass, which is nice. I mean, we are of course using some skills, but we are mainly focusing on the auto attack. Storm Shepherd is good. So, do these have replacements? Guys, actually my build is still not great. The Storm Hearts are a must, of course. You also need the Korvax brand to be able to dual wield. Storm Shepherd is the end game belt, and all of the rest of my gear is pretty much weak. And you need Eye of the Storm, obviously, for the relic. And like I said, the rest is subpar for me. I actually will switch to. This is better. Where is it? Okay, the Shattered Realm set is much better. It makes us much tougher because of the Wondrous +3 max all res bonus on the amulet. Guys, this is insane, right? I mean, take a look. Look at these resistances. 89% lightning resistance. And there's also a proc that we will take a look. That allows us to gain 6% more max resistance, so we will have 95% lightning resistance. But the thing is, my resistances are not really optimized with the Shattered Realm armor, so I haven't switched to this. This can be obtained from, big surprise, Shattered Realm. But the problem is, guys, the chest is easy. I think you can obtain it from doing Shattered Realm level 20. But the rest is a bit harder. Amulet is, I think, 30. I'm not really sure. Mantle should be 40 or 45. And the helmet is from level 60, guys. And level 60 is actually pretty hard. I mean, with this character, I was barely able to do 20. I mean, I could maybe pull off 25 or maybe even 30, but the rest would not be possible. So how do I have these? I have these thanks to the build that I haven't made a video yet, and that's really, really powerful. That's my third character. We will see this in the next video. So, double Stormheart is a must. And like I said, this comes from a quest line. So, as for the rest, use Korvax brand is a must as well. You should probably have the proper relic, and if you cannot get this, get something with lightning damage. Storm Shepherd is for belt, and like I said, if you can manage, get the Shattered Realm set. If you cannot, just get stuff with lightning damage bonus and obviously enough defensive stats. As you can see, my character here, guys, my offensive ability is pretty great, right? I mean, don't get me wrong here, the Unassuming Crate is a hugely powerful boss minion, so the rates you see here are actually unnecessarily low. Let me demonstrate. I'll just hit something somewhere. Let me go here. Okay, find a monster. Let me show. Let me see now. As you can see, 30% crit chance, guys. Our offensive ability is very good, maybe even a little high, and our defensive ability is horrible, guys. This is low. This has to be like 2.8k. Thing is, guys, you can never bring your own hit chance below 60%. I mean, even if you forego offensive ability entirely, you will have a 60% chance to hit. Same goes for the monster. Even if you have a gazillion defense, the monster's hit chance can never go below 60%. So why invest in defensive ability? Thing is, guys, if you ignore the defensive ability, the monsters will be able to crit you. I mean, just like how the offensive ability works for us, the defensive ability works the same. If the monsters have a higher hitting chance than 90%, they will be able to crit you. So for example, if a monster has a 95% of chance hitting you, that would mean they will have a 5% chance of critting you. So that's why we want to keep this below 90% for all monsters. I mean, we are not trying to get them down to 60%, but we would like to avoid crits, because guys, if bosses crit you, that's bad, right? I mean, yeah, we want this to be around 2.8k or so, so the bosses won't crit us. That's about it. So, like I said, the fixed points in the build are, as I said, the Storm Hearts, which is given free to everyone. This drops pretty often. Storm Shepherd is luck. I mean, if you don't have it, just use something else, of course. And you should try to get Eye of the Storm. As for the classes are Demolitionist and Shaman. We are Elementalist, yeah. So we get max Fire Strike, obviously, and max everything that supports Fire Strike. We also get Searing Strike. These small abilities with low level cap, guys, do not get affected by plus all skills. I mean, we do not have plus all skills here, but still. So we max everything here. We got Flame Touched maxed again. This is a toggled aura ability. Gives us more offensive ability and more lightning damage. And we just invest 1 point in here because it gives us a little more damage, and that physical damage gets converted into lightning damage, blah blah. So we get this wondrous nice defensive proc called Blast Shield. This gives us plus 6 max all res, guys. So, and it activates when our health goes below 60%, 11.5 seconds recharge, 4 second duration. And with the Shattered Ground set, guys, you can actually go around 90-95 resistance, depends on which resistance it is. And this is and let me explain how good that is. A regular character will have 8 lightning resist, right? And if they get attacked with a 10,000 damage lightning attack, they will receive 2,000, right? I mean, that's the damage we perceive, guys, the 2,000. And if with 95% resist, you get attacked with a 10,000 lightning, you receive 500 damage, guys. So this is like a 75% damage reduction compared to the 80% resist. That's why it's powerful. We are maxing this out. So we invest points in Flashbang because Flashbang reduces the target's defensive ability, so we can crit more. And the Searing Light passive allows us to fumble their attacks. They will miss or they will do less damage. And Termite Mine gives them minus elemental resist. This is very important, guys. In Grim Dawn, resistance reduction is one of the most important things that you can do, because in the end game, monsters will have a lot of resistances, and you need to pierce those resistances. I mean, it also works with a monster that has 0% resist, and if you do to 34% minus elemental resistance, that would give you 34% damage bonus. But guys, imagine the monster having 100% damage resistance, and we have 50% resistance reduction, just for the convenience of calculation. So you are trying to do 100 damage, you actually deal 0 damage, right? And with 50% resistance reduction, you will start doing 50% damage. Yeah, 50 damage. That's how effective it is. It actually increases 0. Let's say 99%, guys. And you are actually doing 1 damage, and 50% damage resistance reduction allows you to do 51 damage, guys. 5,100% damage boost. Yeah. So the elemental resistance reduction, resistance reduction is especially good if the monsters have a lot of resistances, so you can pierce them. And you always want above 100% resistance reduction, guys, because like I said, in Ultimate, the super bosses especially have a resistance of 95%, 100% or so. So you need to pierce those resistances. The monsters also do have resistances as well. And we also invest 1 point in the Ulzuin's Wrath. Well, allows us to... I think I skipped Vindictive Flame. Yeah, Vindictive Flame is another aura. Gives us some damage. And we also have a chance to knock back, which you just saw. That's the Demolitionist. And as for Shaman, we go for the Wind Devil, which is another resistance reduction mechanic, guys. So there is it. There it is. 37% resistance reduction with this. We max this out. We just place 1 point into Wind Devil, guys. And we also assign a... We will come to that, but we assign some devotion points that also penetrate resistances, guys. Like I said, this is very important. If you are doing some kind of non-physical damage, you should have resistance reduction. And in Grim Dawn, I haven't seen many physical builds. Most of the builds have are doing some sort of damage other than physical, and that's why you need the resistance reduction. 1 point into Maelstrom as well. That's some additional damage. And finally, we, as for the exclusive power, we have the Stormcaller's Pact, which gives us lightning damage. So these are the auras we have. And for the components, we use Seal of the Void on the weapons. On the helmet, we use Living Armor. So armor absorption, so guys, for example, this build is a bit like I said, incomplete. The armor absorption should be as close as to 100% as you can, because thing is, guys, you have resistances for all sorts of damage except physical, and as for physical, you have the armor. But thing is, a monster hits you, I mean, the probability distribution is over there, and it's decided which slot it hits. For example, it hits the armor, and we have a armor rating of 1400 there, and the armor absorption is 78%. So it will absorb 78% of 1400 from that hit, guys. So armor absorption is actually damage saved. So if you bring up your armor absorption to 100%, guys, instead of 70%, you are actually saving a lot of damage, right? I mean, if we receive a hit that deals 1000 damage and our armor absorbs 30% of that, 70% of that, you will be taking a hit of 300. And if our armor actually absorbs 100%, you will not take a hit. I mean, you will take zero damage. That's that. Of course, thing is, in Ultimate, the hits are bigger than your armor rating. So you are not receiving zero, but you will receive some damage, but the armor will counter a lot. I don't actually have... Oh, yeah. So guys, I need to update these. I mean, with Shattered Drumset, for example, I could use the scales that give additional armor absorption. So... Thing is, you should have your resistances capped in Ultimate always. All resistances should be capped except for the stun slow resist. Because if you are not capped, that sort of damage will deal too much damage to you and you will die. And try to have everything at least 6% above maximum because of the blast shield. So in Shaman, we do not have much. Guys, Shaman is very famously used for this one because this first passive is extremely good, gives you a 30% health, gives us health regeneration bonus, and poison and bleeding durations are reduced. This is a very good passive. I've seen a lot of builds using Shaman and just maxing these out. I mean, 1 point in this one is enough because this is an aura and this boosts that aura, so we need that. And this one provides a nice amount of resistances and armor. It's very nice. So we just max these 1 point in the Mogdogan's pact. So in Shaman we do not really have much. We have seen the demolitions, and for devotion, guys, in when you are doing the devotion, you need some 200 IQ tricks, and by 200 IQ tricks I mean at some point you will have like 7 or 8 points left out of the maximum 55, and you will realize you cannot actually do it like I did. Let me see. Yeah, I mean 0 points in Crossroads, but Revenant is also acquired. I mean the Spear of the Heavens is also acquired, and the trick is, guys, for example, you are not able to get points into Revenant because you do not have 8 Chaos Affinity but only 7. This will happen, guys. So you invest 1 point in the Crossroads Chaos point there, and then you will be able to fill Revenant, and after you fill the Revenant, Revenant will give you 1 Chaos and 1 Primordial point, and after that you can unspec the Crossroads Chaos point, guys. And then you can invest into Spear of the Heavens. So there will come a time where you will have 19 Primordial and 7 Chaos points and a lot of points, but you will not be able to invest points into Revenant. So you will get this one, fill Revenant, then after Revenant you will have 20 and 9, you will unspec this and you can fill the Spear. I mean, there will be several times where you need to do this, but like I said, use the Crossroads trick. I mean, invest in the constellation that gives you points, so you can invest in the constellation you want, and after that unspec. So what do we go for leveling, guys? I like to start with Sailor's Guide because it gives us the movement speed, and movement speed is kind of everything when leveling, especially if you have the leveling gear. And also, I think, yeah, Eel also gives movement speed. And after that, I mean, it's your call, of course. I mean, you can see what I have invested in here. After that point, of course, guys, the Lokar set, for example, if you are leveling with Lokar set, the armor is very low, so you start taking in a lot of damage after some point. And I like getting Ghoul at that point, and just bind the Ghoul to an aura skill that you have, like Mogdogan's pact, so it's always active. So it gives you a 5 second immortality, if you will, every 30 seconds or so. So guys, thing is, it gives you 80% leech, which means you heal for the 80% of the amount of damage that you do. So for example, if you have 15,000 crit, you will heal for 12k, and my HP is around 15k, so it kind of is immortality unless you get stunned and killed. So the other constellations that we use are Hawk, Scholar's Light, Fiend, Viper, there's the Widow, I think, yeah. There is also the Solemn Watcher. Solemn Watcher is very good, guys. It's a very good defensive defensive constellation. And then there is the Ultos. So guys, thing is, the constellations on the outer rims generally do not provide you with any points upon completion. For example, guys, as you can see, Affliction gives us 1 purple and 1 green point, and this gives 0, 0, 0, so you do not have to complete them. You can skip one of those points. I mean, this is not a bad devotion to get, but I mean, in order to complete, because this is quite min max, as you can see, guys, I mean, we barely have enough points, and we are completing the 2 or the 3 end game skills. So this gives us 20% resistance reduction on top of everything that we have. These skeletons do not look like much, but guys, they actually reduce resistances. I mean, the skeletons themselves are not very strong, But thing is, like I said, they reduced resistances. So that's another 25%. And we finally have the Spear of the Heavens, which just does a lot of damage. Arcane Bomb is bound to the left click guys, another resistance reduction. As you can see, we have around 140% resistance reduction also. So the problem with this build is, guys, since it's a bit lacking in defensive ability and the gear is not very very optimal, the damage is pretty nice. Let me show. Okay, let's go somewhere. Let's go to the remnants. Of course, this place is crowded and it's filled with hard monsters. So the problem is our toughness, guys. I mean, we are not very tough. So when it's not very crowded, we don't really need to use the flashbang, etc. Okay, these guys are a problem for us, for example. Okay. As you can see, guys, I mean, even when I'm fighting trash, the HP dropped a bit. So this is the character I was able to kill Lokar with, guys, but it was very very hard, very very close. So thing is, I just did brainless nuking. I used some consumables and especially the Aether clusters, which gives you a 75% damage reduction. I mean, I just went in, started nuking, Ghoul's Blood proc'd. That's kind of 5 second invulnerability. And then I used the Aether cluster, which is also 8 second kind of invulnerability, because 75% damage reduction is quite something, guys. And then I was just very close to killing. So I kited for a few seconds and then I killed him. I managed to kill him like 6 or 7 times, but it was of course very close and very annoying. I have died and failed quite a bit too. So I'm misplaying right now. So we should always keep the Storm Devils active, guys. That's how it's getting played. Storm Devil on cooldown. We should use the flashbangs to reduce the target's defensive abilities, so we can crit often, more often. And finally, we should use the Termite Mines to deal some damage and reduce the resistances as usual. So, and that's about it, guys. It's not a very complicated build to play, because like I said, we are mainly focusing on the left click. Yeah. So this will be dangerous for us. Yeah, as you can see, guys, I mean, I went below half HP there for a while, but I mean, he dies every once and then, but he can handle the ultimate difficulty. Can handle Nemesis as well. I mean, some Nemesis sometimes kill, but generally it works all right. So if you have any questions or suggestions, this is a good build to make the second build, guys. I mean, you make your first character, of course it will fail very hard, like my Eye of Reckoning Templar. And this is a good second build because you are able to get both Storm Hearts, and like I said, the Korvax brand is relatively common. It probably will drop. You have to get the Eye of the Storm. I suggest doing all the quests you can, because some quests give you blueprints as a reward, and just try to optimize everything accordingly so you get max res. And guys, the good thing is, for example, as you can see here, I am getting Silk Swatch on my shoulder and legs, etc. So if I had better gear with more resistance on them, I could actually use offensive stuff instead of the Silk Swatches here. That matters a lot. So that's it for the build. Like I said, any questions, feel free to ask. I'll try to help out. See you. Bye bye.